Recording. And I'm gonna mute all of you except Sanae, and then when Sanae finishes, then okay.
Cool. You're all muted. Okay, all right. So this module, this session that I'm going to be talking to you during is going to be about your visibility fears and how to overcome them. So before I kind of go into the meat and the nitty gritty of this, I just want to kind of share with you a bit about me and, you know, tell you that I haven't always been confident, and especially when it came to making videos and doing live streams, those things did not come easily to me at all. You know, one of the reasons I do what I do in terms of my business and my mission in this business is to help women to use their voice, to help women to speak out, to be authentic, to be you know, living on purpose, knowing exactly who they are. And the reason that's a huge part of my mission is because I've spent a lifetime not doing that, not being that person. So I used to be the person who would be extremely shy walking into the room hoping nobody would see me. You know, the wallflower. I was shy, I lacked confidence, I had a daily battle with gremlins just going to work, you know, in my day-to-day. Now, I had a successful professional career, but every day I still had to battle with gremlins around, I'm not good enough, you know, what am I doing here, people notice me, people, what if somebody asked me a question in front of other people, you know. So it was just, you know, so to come from that to being able to be very comfortable pressing go live, to make videos every day, to show up online in this huge, you know, sea, is quite a vast difference. So I want to say to you that, you know, I know how it feels. So whatever comes up for you as you're ready to kind of press those posts or press record or go live, I know exactly how it feels. And a lot of the techniques that I'm going to share with you are those that I used for myself to make sure that I was able to do what I do now. And yes, there's a huge element of feel the fear and do it anyway. You know, the only way round is through at the end of the day, but there are techniques that you can use to really support you. And a lot of them, you know, you can dive deep. You can find out really what's at the core, what underpins these fears. Because underpinning all your fears are limiting beliefs about yourself. So time is short today, you know, so I can't go too deep, but I want to kind of touch the surface on those issues for you. So, you know, let's just get clear. Let's define some of the fears that visibility kicks up. It is one of the top three biggest fears up there with death. You know, it's just crazy that we have this kind of innate fear of being visible. And public speaking is the one I'm talking about when I refer to this top three fear. It's a huge fear that people have. And I'm going to talk to you about that in a second, you know, why it's up there as being such a huge top three fear. But, you know, the fears that we struggle with, the common ones would be criticism. You know, we fear being judged. We fear, perhaps it's a fear of success. You know, what happens if we get too big? Or a fear of failure. And when we're talking visibility, that failure is public. So that's a huge fear. A fear of, you know, in line with judgment and criticism, it could be a fear of just, you know, looking stupid or sounding stupid. You know, what if I say the wrong thing? What if there's an expert who's more expert than me who could perhaps say I'm doing something wrong or tell me that I'm wrong? So there's all those kind of fears that come up. And the first thing to understand about any of those fears, whatever your fear is, and as you move through your, you know, process of getting more and more visible, it's important to define the fear. And when you define the fear and connect to it and sit with it and really feel how it feels emotionally, you will come up with a belief. And this core belief is the belief that underpins the fear. Are you all right, Sophia? Yeah. You're tapping your microphone. So underpinning that fear is always a belief about you, a belief that you're holding about yourself. So again, once you've defined the fear, it is really important to look at what is the belief that is underpinning the fear. So generally, the belief you're holding on to will sound like, I'm not good enough. You know, I'm not good enough, therefore I'm open to criticism. Therefore I'm likely to be judged. Therefore I will fail. Therefore I'll look stupid. You know, I'm not good enough is huge. You know, it could be I'll meet with disapproval. So that would underpin a fear of rejection. What if people don't like me? You know, I'll be disapproved of. The more people that see me, the more I'm at risk of rejection. So there's a sense of I'm not worthy, I don't deserve this, I'm not good enough. So this is deep stuff, but when you sit with the fear and identify it and get really specific, a belief about yourself will come up that you need to grab hold of, because when you can get hold of it and do some work on that, you're shining a light of awareness on it. And awareness at the end of the day is the first way, the first movement towards eliminating that negative limiting belief. So when it comes to live streaming, when it comes to videos, so this is the one that most people have the anxiety over, most people have the fear of. The video, the live streaming, that level of visibility really plays into the hands of our most primal fear, and that is the fear of being seen. And this is our most primal fear because we have a part of our brain at the base of our, the top of our spine, at the base of our brain, and it's our lizard brain. It's called our lizard brain because it's our most primitive brain. It's the most primitive part of our brain. This will take over even in the face of logic and reasoning. So this, we call it the lizard brain or the reptilian brain. It houses something called the amygdala, which is the part of our brain that controls our responses, our chemical responses and reactions that kick off the fight or flight response. So this being the most ancient part of our brain, the whole its whole job really is to protect us, to keep us safe. So when we are exposing ourselves and being seen, being more visible, that is in direct conflict with the role of our primitive brain. You know, we don't want to be seen. The whole point is that we stay undercover from our, you know, saber-toothed tigers, bears, all that kind of thing. Now those things don't exist. We've created new fears, criticism, judgment. There are new tigers and bears. So that's why we have this huge innate primal fear of being seen. It goes against everything in our sort of previous nature. And one of the things that's important to understand is the physiological reaction. So when we are in a situation where we're facing something that frightens us, or we're going out there to be seen, what very often happens is that we feel this level of fear, which kicks up a physiological response. If we were in a real situation, so imagine being in a cave, there's a bear at the entrance of the cave, and you are facing that bear. The blood in your brain rushes away from the front of your brain. It rushes away from there into the back of the brain. So this is your prefrontal cortex. This is the part of your brain that manages logic, reasoning, language, all that kind of the newer functioning of our brain that makes us sort of, you know, the most intelligent species on the planet. We don't need that part of our brain in a fight or flight response. Faced with a bear, thinking could get us killed. It creates delay. So all the blood rushes out of that part of our brain straight into the reptilian part of our brain so that we can react as quickly as possible. When that happens, oxygen leaves the front of our brain. we get fuzzy headed. So if you've ever been in a stressful situation where you think about, you know, have you heard of cotton wool head, where you think, you know, I feel really like I've got cotton wool brain today, I can't think straight. When you're stressed, you can't think straight. There's a reason we go stupid when we're stressed, and it's a natural physiological response. There's no oxygen in the front of our brain. So being scared of fluffing your words, being scared of looking stupid, being scared of your brain going blank in preparation, in anticipation of going live on a video, it's actually a self-fulfilling prophecy. It's the fear that is making you go blank, not the blankness that is the thing you fear. Does that make sense? So it's causing a self-fulfilling prophecy. So, you know, that's really annoying. So, you know, just having that level of knowledge that, you know, when you are in that situation of fear, it does something to your brain that is not conducive to being able to show up as, you know, fluent and articulate and how you want to show up. So the other thing I just want to say about kind of, you know, how our brains work in terms of, you know, in the world of personal development, we know that where we focus, where we put our attention, our energy flows, and our brain will notice all the things to back up wherever our attention, wherever our focus is on. So, you know, as soon as you start thinking about a blue car, for example, you walk out in the street, all you'll notice is blue cars, because that's how our RAS works. That's how our brain works in terms of having that focus. It's like our brain is loyal to us. Whatever we're thinking about, our brain will back it up with more evidence to back up whatever it is we're thinking about. So if you're thinking about your visibility strategy, you're thinking about your posts, you're thinking about your videos, and you're holding on to a fear of not being noticed, a fear of people not liking your stuff, a fear of it not working, or, you know, people not enjoying what you have to say or thinking that you look and sound stupid, what you're going to start noticing as you look through Facebook and you scroll through posts and watch other people's videos, you're probably going to start seeing a lack of engagement in Facebook. You're probably going to be noticing all the posts that have tumbleweeds, you know, no responses. You're probably going to pick up on all the negative comments or comments that are slightly not very supportive of a post. You might start noticing posts that are a bit critical and judgmental of others, because that's the world you're creating. So you're, by focusing on those things, because that's what you're afraid of, you're actually creating a reality for yourself that is more frightening than it actually is, or than it actually needs to be. So it's really, again, about putting, when you're thinking about going live, when you're thinking about going, pressing go live, press record, putting your posts out there, focus on all the abundance of support. Focus on all the encouragement, all that wonderful engagement. I've made some of my best friends on Facebook since I've started my business, because it's a wonderful world. It's an amazing place to hang out. But if you're so frightened of it and focused on the negative, that's the world you create for yourself. It's a given. You'll see whatever you want to see, because that's where your focus is. So literally, by focusing there, you are kind of holding yourself back from going live or pressing record on that video. So just be very, very aware of the kind of things you're saying to yourself about the platform that you want to go live on. So, you know, I'm talking Facebook, but I remember when I first started, you know, 18 months ago when Periscope was big, everyone was doing Periscope, and I set myself a challenge, or my coach set me a challenge, because she knew my fear of going live, set me a challenge to do a Periscope, kind of a masterclass, but she kept it 20 minutes, which seemed horrendous to me. But in order to ensure I did it, she told me to post in all the groups I was in, come and join me 6 p.m. You know, I'm going to do a live on Periscope. And I plastered it everywhere. And I was so petrified. I couldn't sleep the day before. I couldn't think straight all that day. And when it came to going live, nobody joined me. Nobody. And I waffled on for 15 minutes. Not a single soul joined me. And as soon as I pressed stop, I deleted it. I didn't even want anyone to see the replay because I could sense I was talking rubbish, or I felt like I was talking rubbish. It was 15 minutes of sheer nerves. So I deleted it and I just wanted to hide. And I actually went to bed and felt awful. And it was only the next day that I shared like a vulnerability post about how it was just the most horrendous experience. And after that, I was focusing on how awful it is when people don't engage. And that's all I saw. Until I kind of switched that thinking around again to know that this is what I need to do for my business. But that was an awful experience. Now I almost don't mind when people don't come on live because, you know, I know people are going to watch the replay. And I'm so used to doing video because I came off live petrified and started doing video because I could take 20 takes and nobody would know. So that's, you know, really how it started. So let's talk about, you know, a few sound techniques that you can use. Or just before I move on, does anyone have any questions just about what I've spoken about so far? Are you happy for me to carry on? Tim's gone away for a bit. No questions? Everyone good? Cool. Okay. So I'm going to give a couple of kind of foolproof techniques to master your, well, self-mastery really, as you're starting to prepare to go online. But one of the things that really made a difference for me, that changed everything for me, was when I got really clear on my compelling reason for doing what I'm doing in the first place. You know, the visibility posting, getting visible in my business, was all just part of a small part of my big vision, should I say. So it's, you have to have a compelling reason. Otherwise, you'll just come up with loads of excuses, loads of reasons why it's not that, you know, it's not that important, and you'll put it off and you'll put it off. So this applies to anything, any new habit, any new conditioning, anything new that you want to start. Get really connected on a visceral level. Get really connected to the bigger reason, the why you're doing this. And one of the ways I like to do this, and I teach this sort of for various kind of uses really, but it's the which means that exercise. So if you want to get really connected and viscerally connected to the reason why you're going to do what you're going to do, then think about, you know, start off by saying, you know, I need to get visible. I want to get visible, which means that. And in between every sentence that you say, connect it to the next sentence with which means that. So I want to go live, which means that people will see me, which means that I will be more visible in my business, which means that I will gain more traction, which means that more traffic to my website, which means that more, you know, raise my profile, which means that I may get a paying client, which means that, you know, money in the bank, which means that. So if you can keep going to the nth level, then it just gives you quite a compelling reason for doing what you're doing. It's not just, I want to go live because that's what I've been told I need to do because everyone else is doing it. That's not going to keep you going. That's not going to keep you motivated. The other thing that is great to get clear on your messaging, your compelling reason, is why you're, again, linked, why you're showing up in the first place. What is the reason for you doing your business? You know, there's a stronger passion in all of us for doing what we're doing. Our mission is so powerful. And very often, it's born out of a place of struggle. You know, we've been somewhere that's pretty shitty. We've been somewhere that has caused us pain, that's been frustrating for us. We've been in a place of struggle, and we are the overcomers. We've walked our way out of that struggle. We've taken a journey. And a lot of the reason, a lot of the passion behind what we do is now we don't want another human being to feel how bad we felt. We know how it feels. We know the long route that it could take. So we want to shorten that journey for our people. You know, it comes from a purpose, a sense of love for other people. So if you, again, you connect to that, get very clear on what your mission is, get very clear on that one person that you want to help, and then just speak to them. Just create messaging purely for them, because then you get out of your head and into your heart. You're more influential because you're speaking from a place of passion. Your ego is not involved, so you forget all about their criticism and judgment fears. You're just coming from the heart. And that's, again, more powerful, a way of connecting with people anyway. You know, you see these videos that people have put out where they're getting really pumped. They're clearly passionate about what they want to say. They are, you know, deeply emotional, you can see. And that's how they become influential, because they elicit a state change in the audience just from talking from the heart, just from being passionate. And it's that state change that will have people connecting with you. And it's that that will help you press go live every time. So for me, that was a huge one, you know, the whole connection with why I'm doing what I'm doing and who I'm doing it for. Why do I want to help this one woman? And I spoke to her every single time. Yeah, so this is along those lines. Just looking at my notes, it's about having a really high intention and low attachment. So your intention is high, it comes from a high place. You know what you want to do, you know what you want to create, you know who you want to help and what your message is that you want to deliver, but don't get attached to it. Don't create a video, put it out there, and then every 5 seconds go back and refresh your screen to see what notifications you've had, because that will drive you crazy. And that is what I did in the outset. And, you know, a big message here is that when you have put your stuff out there, likes and comments don't build a business. Likes and comments do not build a business. It doesn't matter what your posts, what the engagement looks like on Facebook. It's who comes through the door. You know, and at the end of the day, many of my clients have come through the door via private message, you know, via email. And when I've connected with them, they have said, I've been watching you for months, and they've never commented once. I've never heard of these people, you know, and that for me was all I needed to hear, that just once last year. And that was, again, changed everything for me, because I just thought, you just don't know who is watching, who needs you to show up today, because you've been there for them the day before and the day before and the day before. And if you're thinking, I'm not getting any engagement, I need to stop, that's where it pulls away instantly. So it's about persistent and consistent. The next exercise, and Cheryl may know this one, because it is like a managing your inner critic exercise. And it's a Jack Canfield exercise. So I'm going to give full credit where credit is due. I learned this from Jack Canfield. I did it on a live stream, and I actually did it. I did it on myself in order to go live. So I don't know if you remember this one, Sophia, but in order to go live, I took myself through this exercise. It was so powerful that within minutes I pressed go live, and I shared this exercise on that first go live on Facebook. So this one has been another real massive change for me in terms of transitioning from video to live. So this is about how you communicate with yourself, how you and the premise of it is that it's about communicating the truth and getting to the truth. So for example, the example that I want to give is to demonstrate it is if you've got teenagers, for example, and your teenager comes home later than was agreed, and they don't call you, they don't message you, and they just come home late. You've been pacing the floor going crazy because they've not called you. And then the minute they come in, you go crazy. You tell them off. You, what do you think you're doing? You're trying to put me in an early grave, and oh my God, you should have called me. Get upstairs, get out of my sight. And you go mental because you are so angry. That's the message they're getting. That's what you're communicating. But actually, the truth is, I love you so much that if anything happened to you, I don't know how I would cope. That's the truth behind your communication. But in the moment, we respond as we do. So it's kind of like we're going to tell ourselves the truth behind the current level of communication that we're giving ourselves about going live. So we do this in four stages. So if you've got a pen, just write these words down. So the first way we're going to communicate with ourselves is with anger. So we're going to get angry. The second way is fear. We're going to talk to ourselves from a place of fear. We're then going to talk to ourselves from a place of making a request. We're then going to talk to ourselves from a place of love, which is actually the truth. So how this works is, if you think about, this can apply to any situation, including the teenage kid situation, but if we were talking about the desire to go live, press record and post. The first thing is, if you're talking to yourself from a place of anger first, let's get this out. So why would you be talking to yourself and be angry about not going live? So for example, it could be, I'm angry for you holding out on yourself, for holding out on your potential clients. You're a wuss. You're obviously not committed to your own success. You know, this is, everyone does it. For God's sake, what's wrong with you? Why can't you just press go live and talk? You know, you want this. You obviously don't want it enough. So that's you being angry. The next thing then, not angry enough for Portuguese Sophia. She'd be like, So the next thing is fear. So the fear of not pressing go live could sound like, I'm afraid that if you don't do this, you'll miss out. I'm afraid that you won't grow your business as quickly as you want to. I'm afraid that you'll miss out on that recognition that you want. I'm afraid that you'll miss out. I'm afraid that you'll clients, potential clients, will miss out, and I'm really afraid that you'll look back and you will regret this. So that's you talking to yourself from a place of fear. Making sense so far? Nod for me. Yeah, thank you. All right, so Tim's yay. So the third place to then talk to yourself from is then from a place of making requests. So this is where you kind of think about, well, what do you want you to do? So the request could be, right, I want you to go live for 5 minutes a day for the next 5 days. I want you to visualize every day it going brilliantly. I want you to imagine the person that you're talking to and create an avatar. I want you to listen to music, you know, high vibe music before you press go live so that you're energetic, you're feeling pumped and you feel good, and that will come across. So you set yourself these requests. And when you talk to yourself like that, having gone through the anger and the fear, requests just come up as, you know, this is what I need to do in order to move forward. It just comes up naturally. It's amazing. And then the final conversation you're going to have with yourself is with love. So then you would say, I love you. You deserve to have success and abundance. You deserve to feel proud of yourself, and I want you to experience the sense of satisfaction that this will bring. I want you to step into it. I want you to enjoy the clients that will come to you as a result of your increased visibility. So that's then talking from a place of love. Makes sense? Yay. So that's like turning your inner critic into your inner coach. Talk through anger, fear, request, and then love. And when I did that Canfield exercise on myself, I'm sorry, there's some chat here. It's now as an experiment. If anybody has any questions, please unmute. Yeah, so please, any questions, don't let me rabble on without asking if anything's coming up.
Before you do any videos, do you, I wouldn't say write a script for yourself, but do you go over in your head or rehearse what you're going to say or create notes before, especially for a live when you're on the spot? Do you find that that helps you prepare?
Yeah. Generally, I do have notes, so I've got some structure. And I think it helps to kind of keep on track, because I very easily can get excited and go off track. And I respond very quickly to when you get people who make comments, that can send me off in another direction. So if I've got notes, that tends to keep me, just bullet points, Sophia, that tends to keep me on track. When I'm doing a video, I tend to just, I don't know whether this resonates, but I feel that alive is alive, isn't it? You're open to kind of other people's comments, being kind of impromptu, being off the cuff, expecting the unexpected. But with a video, I'm probably more likely to look a bit more prepared and have more notes, probably rehearse it a bit more, because the video is likely to go into YouTube. It's likely to go on my page. It might go on my website. So I do have a bit more preparation for a video.
Awesome. Yeah, I've noticed that for myself. When I've gone live and I feel like I've got a great idea, and probably a few minutes in, you have a brain freeze, and that either leads to going off what comments are made, or I go to a defense, which is almost repeating myself. So I end up repeating the same points a few times, which could be good for somebody who jumps in late, but someone watches the replay, they're getting the same thing three times. So I know I want to have something that feels a little bit more organized. I mean, I don't want to be completely scripted when I go live. I want to come off authentic and from the heart, but I feel like a little bit of structure would help.
Do you ever watch your live streams back?
Once in a while, after preparing to cringe at the sound of my own voice. I mean, I love being visible. I love putting myself out there, but there used to be just something about the sound of my recorded voice that hearing it back just made me cringe. I don't know what, maybe that's my inner critic. Cheryl can help me with that.
Yeah.
But just something that it dates back to even when I was working in the corporate finance world, and someone played one of the recordings of one of my client calls in a customer service training. And like, I was honored, but I was also fearing having to listen to it in class and have to explain why I sounded like Michael J. Fox drunk on the phone.
That probably was a one-off. I think it's quite good to listen, to watch yourself back, because in my experience, when I do a live, and live, you know, it's never going to be 100% comfortable, I don't think, you know, just because you're conscious that people are coming in and out. If you're watching if people are joining and leaving, or if people are making impromptu comments, you've got to kind of concentrate on what you want to say and engage with the comments. There's a lot going on. Very often I would come off a live stream and thinking, oh God, that didn't go well. Or one of the things that when you said I repeat myself, I thought, God, how many times did I repeat myself in that? When I watch them back, because I do tend to critique them myself, when I watch them back, it's never, ever, ever as bad as I think it was or how I perceived it to be. And I think that's the case for many people. When they watch them back, they just think, oh, it wasn't that bad. Oh, your microphone, I can't hear you, Sophia.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, that's good.
So isn't watching the video again back, it's going to make it worse? I prefer not to watch it.
Okay. That's entirely, that's personal choice if you don't. But what don't you
like? Because it's so, Facebook Live is so set in stone. whatever it happened, it happened. It's been posted, it's out there. So looking it back for me, okay, I'll look back at it to like improve it for next post. Or yeah. I might remember, oh no, I'm going to do a post about this A, B or C, something different that the first video has reminded me. But no, I don't. But I watch other people's videos over and over if I have to.
Right. But it's just yourself.
Yeah, it's just myself. I don't watch myself enough. I like to listen to others, though.
Yeah. And maybe it's, you know, getting really comfortable with seeing yourself might help. If you're really comfortable with watching yourself and ridding any of that cringe factor that could arise, then it gets more comfortable to go out there and go live.
Oh God, in the beginning it was like, oh, I've got to have my hair done, I've got to have some makeup, I've got to have my nails done. Do you know what I mean? It's all those things. It's like, no, I can't go live now. I just don't look decent. It's hot. But now it's weird because I don't give a crap. And people want to listen to me more than how I look like. I look like how I look like, you know. But they want to listen to what I have to say.
Which says a lot about, and this is, you know, we talk about how we judge others, how we judge ourselves. So if you're not thinking, well, I don't care if I've got makeup on, it makes no difference, that says to me that when you tune into a video, you really connect with what somebody's saying. And that's lovely because you're not judging what they look like. You're just there to hear the message. And that's what we all want ultimately, isn't it? That just, we want to be heard. We want to use our voices. That's where the power is. It's not about what the person looks like. So, you know, it's judgment-free zone, which is great.
And you know exactly if that person that has listened to the video, you know, you've got like the analytics that tell you exactly how many views your video had and for how long. So don't try and pretend that you've listened to the whole video when you haven't. And you know exactly when somebody's listened to the whole video because they are commenting on certain areas of the video.
Yeah.
About what you're saying. So.
Yeah. And, you know, in response to Tim's point there, I remember when my coach earlier this year said, the moment you stop caring what others think, that's just so freeing. You know, it just will change everything. And it does take a lifetime to master. It does. It's hard because you care. But if we didn't, imagine. We'd be out there rocking it.
Yeah.
But I think it's not necessarily... it's less about worrying what other people think because I no longer worry what other people think. You know, I will say what I want to say. I do, you know, I if I swear, and I noticed Tim, you'd put, I actually dropped an F-bomb on a podcast. You know, if I swear, then I do suddenly go, oh God, and I cringe at the thought of it because I think, is that me? Is that not me? I don't know. But, you know, I have mixed feelings about swearing. Some people will just swear away.
I don't think it was really an accident. I was I was really passionate about my philosophy at that point, and it just came out. And then afterwards, after we recorded, I'm like, "Oh, my mom's gonna see that." But so I don't apologize for having done it. I'm not somebody who frequently swears in my content. It's just it comes up when it. Comes up and fits the energy of where I'm going. So, you know, it's there. It's not something frequent. And I mean, I kind of have a good laugh about it and also kind of award myself for being brave enough to just let loose however I'm just express whatever's on the heart. Yeah. And, you know, if it comes out with a few naughty words, then okay, it it does, and that's it, me expressing myself. I'll go throw a few quarters in the swear jar after and wash my mouth off with soap, and we're good.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So just, you know, the main thing really in terms of making sure that you can do what you want to do and press go live, press record, is to breathe. That's a huge thing. And just to kind of connect with that primal fear, physiological aspect. 7-11 breathing. Have you ever heard of 7-11 breathing? Is a technique to help with your physiological response, because again, the body communicates with the mind. So if you're in a fear state, the body will have this chemical reaction and hormonal release that will then create the fuzzy head, the blankness, the, you know, and it propagates the fear. So again, that self-fulfilling prophecy. So nose breathing, deep inhale through your nose, that sends oxygen directly into your brain. So it supports that functioning. But also, let's go back to the situation of being in a cave with a bear. If you've gone through the fight or flight response, either way, but you've come off good, what happens then is you tend to, say you've run up a tree and you're hiding up a tree and you feel safe again, what you will automatically do in any time where you're releasing tension is you will do a really big exhale. That's like, oh, release. And that's a natural response. And what that does is it engages your parasympathetic nervous system, which is the system that is the opposite to the stress reaction, the sympathetic nervous system. So it's a bit like a pinball in a machine. It goes ding, 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 ding. That big exhale sets off a chain reaction to then reduce, eliminate, get rid of all the chemicals, all the hormones, all the stress reactions. So that big exhale just goes, oh, we're not in a stress situation anymore. Oxygen floods your brain, your body relaxes, your stomach stops holding tight, you can breathe again. So one of the techniques that is really powerful for engaging that relaxed state is where you inhale through your nose for 7, and then you exhale for 11, a count of 11. So the exhale is bigger than the inhale. And that will create that physiological response inside your body. So just breathe, always breathing. Breathe through the stress and the fear. So, any questions, anyone, anything anybody wants to add, any experiences you've had? My son's just come home. So we're pretty good. Sophia, I can't hear you.
I'm just going to unmute everybody.
Okay.
You can unmute yourselves. Anoxana, do you have any questions?
Yes, Sanae, would you recommend just to start with videos? Obviously, it's easier because you can always kind of delete if you don't like it. And is there any recommendation what length of the, you know, where kind of, you know, how long, you know, to begin with videos and anything that you can share with from your experience?
Yeah, I mean, I would say just initially be kind to yourself. Keep it short. Don't set really high expectations and a high bar for yourself. It's just about getting going. So keep it short to start with. Keep it concise. Just make it an introduction. You know, as Sophia said in one of her posts, come and post in MYM to start with, where it's just, you know, just the 9 of us, it feels safe, it's comfortable. Create an introduction. A lot of groups ask, you know, come and introduce yourself, and you can do that in, you know, any one of our groups, I'm sure. Just come and introduce yourself, talk about, you know, what you do,
okay,
by video. And just, you know, you don't have to have a beginning, middle and end and any big wisdom that you're sharing, but just this outset, get comfortable with what you're doing and grow it.
Did you actually get any training, like voice training or any kind of like camera training? Is that going to help in some ways to get more confident, or that's not really something that you guys do?
Because I wanted to create workshops, so I did a lot of training offline, and I did a professional speakers academy training. Mm-hmm. But it was very much about how to deliver a workshop from a stage.
I see.
But it did help me in delivery, you know, diction, being clear where you want your emphasis on your words. But I will say something about that. That was 2 years ago. I don't think I do any of those things now. All the things I was taught were ways to kind of hold yourself and deliver. And it just, as I get more comfortable, as I become myself, I don't think I do any of that. So whilst it may have helped me in the beginning, I don't think I use any of those techniques now.
What you're saying probably is kind of they train sort of professional people, you know, from the traditional point of view, how to be professional, and because we want more to show ourselves, you know, who we are, therefore it probably can be not very useful. Okay.
Yeah. The biggest thing we can do for ourselves is learn techniques that go before and after the video. So breathing techniques, meditation, visualizing it going really, really well, and you know, visualizing you being mega successful and loving going live. Visualize yourself loving it, being confident, being you know, fluent in what you're saying and articulate, then that is probably one of the best things you can do.
Well, I have a few processes, like 68 process, if you know Abraham Hicks, where you actually talk about something that already happened to how you want it to be, and it actually shifts, you know, your vibrations within 68 seconds. So it's a good process. If anybody is interested, I can share. But that's great, and thank you for your presentation. I love the techniques, the four steps, and is really good. Definitely, you know.
Yeah, good. The which means that is actually a sales tool. So I used to teach it when it came to sales coaching. Because it's about, like, if you have to create a one line about, in response to somebody's question, what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
And you're struggling to come up with that really nifty one liner that will make people go, God, how do you do that? Then start with what you want, say, like, oh, well, I help women find a career that they love. Then it's which means that. And it always leads to, when we do it with the sales kind of thing, it always leads to, because they'll ultimately be happy, they'll ultimately be fulfilled. So it's a lovely technique to kind of get yourself to that state of being clear on why you're doing what you're doing. And that
it's good to write it down and just really...
Yeah, it's lovely.
Yeah.
And that reason will suddenly become bigger than the fear. And for me, it got to a point where the thought of not doing this was worse than the thought of doing it. You know, I would be so angry with myself if I just let this fear overcome me.
Definitely. And I think, you know, what worse can happen, you know, so that's kind of my new mantra, you know, what's worse can happen, because I'm obviously, you know, very grateful for this group and for everything that Sophia is offering us. And I'm a tiny bit more confident with social media. So I'm really happy. Yeah. Really kind of
awesome.
Exciting. Fantastic. Thank you, Sanae and Sophia and team.
Thank you. Now, I just want to add to that, Oksana, things that you should like look at before you go on videos: the script, the lighting. Like, you see, it's getting really dark here, and I haven't even thought about lighting, but I've got lights in front of me. I can just pop it on, sort of thing. But lighting, the script, so you not lose your thoughts. And on Facebook Live as well, Tim if you're talking about something, don't feel that you have to go back if somebody comes in the middle of the conversation. Do you see what I mean? Because imagine you're like in this reunion or a party or whatever, and you're talking to one person, okay? And then another person comes in the middle of the conversation. You don't stop and suddenly turn around and say, oh, yeah, we've been talking about this and this and this. You just continue, and that person kind of like goes in or watches the replay. You can always turn around and say, watch the replay in the beginning if you're, you know, if you're just, or if they come in the middle, so watch the replay and put your comments later on or something. The lighting, a script, confidence. And because I used to think, like, because of my accent, nobody could understand me. But,
right. Yeah.
And I suppose you probably think that too, Oksana, don't you?
So. Yeah, to some extent. It's part of my, how I'm going to show up. You know, English is not my first language, but, you know, yeah, I've got that. But when I am in the flow, I think I'm pretty fluent. And yeah, my accent is not that bad and people can understand.
And I think my accent is quirky. Do you know what I mean? It's like people know that I'm not English and people know that I'm going to say some words really silly and I can't say them, like spontaneity.
Oh, yeah.
But in my brain, I think about other words that means that. And then, which means that. And I just say them like simpler. And sometimes that's a good thing for me because if I keep it simple, then people turn around and say, oh, it's amazing how you can just keep it so simple, you know. So, yeah, it'd be an advantage.
Yeah, keep it simple, yeah. Don't use sophisticated words or, you know, very complex sentences, that's for sure. Yeah.
So that's just my thoughts.
Thank you.
Cool. So if nobody else has any more questions, then I'll stop recording. And we'll see, you know, each other again on the next call, which will be tomorrow. Jennifer Hall is going to talk about niche. Yeah?
Yeah. Great.